we've got a panel of three practitioners. These guys are currently in the process of building models, trying to meet decision makers' needs, and I think they'll have some very insightful comments about the processes they use. So this is an energy industry panel. We've got people with backgrounds in electric utilities and oil and gas. And I want to start off by just asking them a few questions that kind of allows them to introduce themselves. We have Corey Welch from Lumadyne. We have Kurt Reinhart from Epex. And we have Mazen from SGD.
Okay,
SDG. You get these initials, and it gets kind of interesting. You just kind of mix S's and D's and G's up, and it works out fine. So I want to start out by asking Corey a question. I mean, Corey's working on models that forecast the adoption and impacts of distributed energy resources for utilities. And the first question I want to ask Corey, and maybe the people in the audience might be interested in this, is why are you doing this? Why is this an important issue to address?
All right, thanks, Dan. Distributed energy, when I'm talking about distributed energy resources, I'm really talking about technologies such as rooftop solar PV, electric vehicles, battery storage, energy efficiency, and demand response. And over the course of the last, 5-10 years, those technologies have been changing very, very rapidly. Costs have been coming down faster than anybody ever forecast 10 years ago. That's an interesting study in probability all by itself, as I'm sure Max could expound upon at length. But battery technology have been coming down the learning curve. Solar PV has just been in improving dramatically over the course of the last decade. And so these technologies are changing the utility electricity distribution system more rapidly than they have in the past. When rooftop solar PV comes into a territory and the economics are favorable, it can change the supply and demand picture and balance very, very quickly, and more quickly than traditional planning techniques have been able to deal with. Likewise with electric vehicles. Solar PV will reduce load in a particular area. Electric vehicles, as they come in, will increase load in an area. Those two don't always overlap and offset, because oftentimes they're in very different places. So the bottom line is electric utilities, with these rapidly changing technologies that are changing the supply and demand mix very quickly, need better ways to forecast demand to make sure that they're making good investments on the electric distribution system. Do they need a new transformer in a particular area? Do they have to upgrade a substation? Is this circuit going to be overloaded because I have 10 EVs with fast chargers coming in? They need better ways to understand impact on their system to make good investment decisions, so they're not either over-investing or under-investing, because both of those are bad.
Thanks, Corey. So I want to turn a similar question over to Mazen here, which is, I've talked with him. He's working in a lot of different areas, but one of his interesting work areas is on electric utility distribution systems, so it's kind of similar to some of the issues that Corey's dealing with. But Mazen, can you tell us a little bit about your work and what kind of questions you're trying to answer?
Good morning. Thanks, Dan. Yes, continuing on what Corey presented, we were asked 6 years ago to work with a player in transmission and distribution and help them optimize the allocation of their annual CapEx and maintenance budget across the transmission and distribution network. So we built a decision support solution initially in Excel, and that takes large data sets at the component level and the subsystem level throughout the T&D network, looking at we take data on who's the manufacturer, the age, calendar age of each component, and the effective age, if there's increased corrosion in that specific area or not. And from that, we come up with the probabilities of failure at the level of each component and subsystem, and look at the level of redundancy in a specific region, the distribution of loads, and the population distributions across the region or the area. And from that, we look at, given a failure and a cascading failure, what is the total economic cost? And we introduce the total economic cost framework, which takes into account what we're spending as the operator of the T&D system, and what is the cost implication of a power outage across the customer segments that will be impacted, and came up with the overall framework to optimize the allocation of their CapEx and budget on an annual basis. Recently, we ported that system, after they have used it in Excel for a number of years, we ported it to run on a GIS system from Esri. It's completely web-based. And now we're investigating the use of IoT data from IoT devices that they're thinking of deploying throughout their T&D network, and also our AI-based system that looks at drone images, and from that figure out if there is an impingement on a specific line or potential failure of a component or system, and make use of that in real time. So this is not yet implemented in the system, in the solution, but we're working on it, and this is where we're headed with that.
Okay, so before I move on to you, Kurt, I want to make sure that Corey and Mazen can talk about the complexity of the problem they're facing. I mean, if you look at any kind of electric utility distribution system, you've got a very diverse set of equipment, spatially distributed, and it's a very complicated decision. These are large network models. And, you know, kind of dealing with these big, complex, integrated systems, can you talk a little bit about, you know, how you've managed to get data and how you've managed to kind of address this? Really, it's a very, very large network that you're working with.
I guess I'll start with solar PV, because that's the distributed energy resource, at least in California, where some of my largest clients are, that has had the largest impact on the electricity distribution grid. Fortunately, every time somebody installs a solar PV system, they have to have some kind of an interconnection agreement with the electric utility. So there are currently about 800,000 rooftop solar PV systems in the state of California, and every single one of those systems that has been installed, they have information on where it was installed, you know, the specific location, address, when it was installed, the technology that was installed. You can have the type of customer, so you can have demographics associated with that. So you really have a data set of almost a million data points of installations that you can use basically to help you understand adoption patterns and not only where these systems are likely to go in spatially, but also how quickly and over time if you combine that data with other modeling efforts. Not just econometrics or regression, but causal models with dynamics and feedbacks associated with them. If you combine all of those, you can start to get a very good picture, and I think a reasonably accurate picture of where those systems are going to be installed over time so that they can make good decisions.
So following up on that, Mazen, can you talk about the dimensionality and complexity of the problem you're dealing with?
Yeah, in terms of the systems and components, there's a lot of data, and again, due to regulations, the operators have to keep track of this data, and because of also site and field service visits and trips, they keep track of observations as well. And then you have also data eventually that's really be coming from the IoT sensors that are going to be on power lines, on substation levels and components, transmitting all that data and making use of it. So, and the technology evolves in a way to help us solve the complexity that we create from other sources. So AI and machine learning are coming just in time to help us solve some of these complex systems that we've created, and making use of the data to take that data and convert it to knowledge to support decision making will require that we do use data analytics, large data analytics, machine learning, because the amount of data no single person can assimilate and bring to bear to any specific decision that they're dealing with, whether they're looking at the overall network and figuring out how to optimize the allocation of CapEx or budgets, or if they're looking at potentially responses to specific occurrences that may happen in real time. So I think the data analytics and machine learning methodologies will help us deal with the complexity that we have created ourselves. Okay.
So Kurt, you're kind of the oil and gas person on the panel. Can you talk a little bit about the questions you're trying to answer for clients and how you go about it?
Sure. Thanks, Dan. So it's interesting hearing these other two gentlemen, because they're both working with these very large integrated distributed systems, and you have a lot of specific data that's generated within that. Sort of a main task that we've had in our consulting is doing oil and gas production forecasting. So literally trying to figure out how much oil and gas is going to come out of the ground when you put a hole in it in a given place. And so there's some similarities there. We have some spatial aspects to the data. But fundamentally, if you're working for a large oil and gas operator, you will have very detailed information about drillings and completions for the wells that are owned by that company. But if you're working outside of that space, for example, with an investment group or something like that that might be wanting to invest in these, you don't have access to those very specific data. What you have are some large general data sets that are required by the states in terms of revenue reporting and this and that. So a big challenge for us has been to comb through all of that data to make the connections to bring that together so that then we can build a system. And at that point, sort of as you gentlemen were talking about, having a sort of machine learning process that can try to comprehend this data and then make predictions from it, that's really what we do. Once we have the first step of being able to process all that data, the real challenge then is building a system that can be continuously updating, that's always available, that can spit out those predictions when we need them, or when there's a potential investment or CapEx opportunity.
Okay, so Corey, I've kind of been working in the field for many years, and it's an amazingly challenging task. I mean, what have you found are kind of methods and approaches that you use to develop these forecasts?
I'd say we use a combination of methods. In fact, I think all of the modeling that we do uses a combination of methods. I'd call them all multi-method or systems approaches. One of the main things we use is a field called system dynamics. So it's very interesting to hear Warner and Max talk about causality, because from the world that I come from, the systems world, A does not usually just cause B, or it doesn't go in a linear progression, and it doesn't go from left to right. It's often A causes B, and then B also has an influence on A. Everything affects everything else. Everything is really interconnected. And so the types of models that we build are causal models that have stocks and flows and feedbacks and inertia, and can represent or simulate the complex dynamics that you tend to see in real-world systems. So that's one aspect of what we do, and we apply technology diffusion theory. We calibrate technology diffusion models to historic time series data. And one of the things that I'm seeing in other parts of the industry, or in other folks who are tackling the same problem, is that they're not using those types of real, they're not really as focused, I think, on the real causality, and they're not using methods that are available to them because there are so much data, there are so much data out there to work with, and with the advent of AI and so forth, that people are latching on to techniques, I think, and trying to look at things from a perspective that is kind of throwing the baby out with the bathwater, if you will. And I've seen a lot of analysis and a lot of computational effort and research and runtime of machines trying to predict behavior using these techniques, these newer techniques, that ignore the causality part of it and the systems part of it, and provide worse forecasts at greater cost. So that's a cautionary tale in my mind, is to not throw the baby out with the bathwater and really make sure you're utilizing all the techniques that are available out there.
So you think that worse forecasts at greater cost is not an improvement?
I do not. Not typically. At least not in my world.
I just wanted to throw that out there and make sure that everybody kind of caught that point in terms of these things. So Mazen, in terms of kind of practical tools, and how do you, you're given this project, how do you approach it?
I want to comment first on the data and the implications, and then talk about how we approach these projects. I'd like to emphasize that data and the large data analytics that we're using are not just helping us on the information element of the decision basis or the information element of the DQ. It's really helping us improve decision quality across multiple dimensions. First, from identifying a decision opportunity, because some of the data in many of these situations, the availability helps us identify a decision opportunity which we would have missed altogether. It helps us improve the frame. In many cases, the whole frame and what alternatives we have available to us is improved because of the data and the way we are able to visualize it and the way we can evaluate the alternatives. So it's really impacting decision quality across multiple dimensions, and I'll talk more about that later. Now, in terms of how we approach these projects, we take a very decision-focused approach to designing these decision support systems, and we've done that back in the 90s when we worked on the offshore Gulf of Mexico Deepwater Division portfolio management system for Shell, and that's publicly known. It's very publicized as a project. We take a decision-focused approach. We identify the decisions and analyses that you'd like to see as a decision maker in that context on an ongoing basis. And that drives the overall design of the system. And in more and more, we're also doing an iterative approach. Not only we look at the start with the decisions that you want to enable and support, we look at the data that you have available to you, because that also informs back and forth, oh, you can also look at these decisions, Mr. Decision Maker, or Ms. Decision Maker, would you like these decisions to be included, yes or no? So that's an important part of the design, the front-end design of the system. And then from there, we start looking at, okay, the frequency of the decisions, what are the helpful displays and analyses you'd like to see on an ongoing basis, and another decision support solution and dashboard that we designed for a sovereign that produces a key energy commodity. We took into consideration who are the users of the system. And in that case, very high level executives in government at the ministerial level, cabinet level, were going to use this web-based solution on an ongoing basis. So that drives the design as to the displays, the insights that you're going to recommend or write next to the displays, and who can access the system at what level. So always we need to look at the decisions you're going to support, the data that you have available, and the users that you have in mind for the system.
Okay, thanks, Mason. So Kurt, how do you avoid producing worse forecasts at higher cost?
I'm not sure that I do. No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. Actually, that's so again, in oil and gas space, in terms of forecasting production, really, there are a lot of industry standard practices, and so most of the big operating companies are going to have a staff of petroleum engineers who will look through the data, and they'll sort of pick what they think is a representative data set, and they'll do some kind of curve fitting by eye. There's a lot of judgment, and it's based on a lot of interpretation of physical principles and subsurface, physical realities and all this. Or, we can come in and we can say, let's take a bunch of data and let's find the best fitting curves to these data, or let's partition these data this way. And so we can approach it from a purely statistical side. So often we will find ourselves in a situation where the question is asked, does it work? Does your method work? We don't usually use statistics to do this. How do we know that your system works? And so we've always built in a very robust model validation stage where we can use past data and we do out-of-sample prediction and we can score the accuracy and precision of our forecasts. What's interesting, though, is in a lot of these cases where we can come in and present that, we're actually comparing ourselves to a system that doesn't have any validation, doesn't have any validation data. It's not typical in an expert-driven system that they might blind themselves to some data, make expert predictions, and then score themselves on it. And so there's often a disparity in how the different communities in the industry approach that task, and it's very difficult to bridge this gap of, is your forecast good, and is it worth the money, and that sort of thing. And it's further complicated by the fact that you might not really know for 10 or 15 years how that well's going to do. And so it's all based on inferential statistics and measurements from those data when you have them available. There's another thing that comes up often is the difference between validating a model, which is measuring how well it performs, versus verifying a model. And that's making sure that it has the right pieces in it, that it's put together properly. And so there's also this tension, again, in when you're working alongside, when you're trying to introduce real data-driven techniques in an expert system, the experts are, because they don't have empirical validation on their results, they're looking for a process or methodological verification for how the model was built. And we have spent a lot of times in conversations with experts where you finally get to the point and say, I'm not sure that we're going to be able to verify the process of a Bayesian edited regression tree versus, your geophysical property model that you have. And so there's often that tension, and our fallback is that empirical validation. But when data analytics and big data are coming into a new space in an industry, there's not preparation really to be able to interpret and understand and value that. So the short version is we have evidence that supports our claim that our forecasts are better, but there's not really a level playing field there yet in order to say who's better or just how well is it working compared to the alternatives.
Okay. So, you know, just kind of listening to your answer, it seems that you're trying to build a model that represents a reasonable process, you know, how these decisions are made. And so people view the information coming out of that model as higher quality based on how you put the process together. And so is that fair?
Yeah, and I think there's sort of layers to it. We can build a decision model around making investments or committing resources to drilling. And that makes sense, and everybody can agree to that. But then when you come to maybe the core of it, which is actually making some kind of physical prediction, we're actually going to apply technologies that may not be transparent to the client. And you know, the watchword in the industry as consultants and as decision analyst professionals is you always want these things to be transparent. You want people to understand the tool and have confidence in it and be able to use it. And yet, I get in my car and drive it here this morning, and I'm not sure how that works. I'm just confident it's going to work when I get in there and turn the key. And I think for this type of analytics we're talking about, I think we're just at the cusp now where we're trying to sort out what are the bits that we need to be transparent about. Because I think in 10 years' time, everybody's going to be used to it enough that you can just say, oh, yeah, we've got an algorithm that does that. Just like when I turn on my phone, it connects to the internet. I don't know how, but now let's just try and figure out how well is it working, not how does it actually have to, you know, we can't all be experts in that piece of it. So we're kind of juggling those two sides of it, trying to be transparent and explicit about modeling the decision, but also recognizing that we want to bring the best tools to play. And unless somebody devotes their time and their career to that, they're not really going to understand how those things work.
Okay. Thanks, Kurt. So I want to turn to some questions in a minute, but I want to give each of the panelists an opportunity to sum up on what they think has been kind of the most important challenge in their work and how they've tried to address it. And then we've got some very interesting questions that go to. So I want to give each of you to say what's unique about the way you've approached the problems and is, you know, if you wanted to kind of give a lessons learned, what have you learned from your modeling that you would like to relate to other people? So Corey, I'm going to give you. Well, I figured you should be first in all these things, and that way, you know, they can critique your questions and work from.
Shooting from the hip here a little bit. I am very big into the transparency side of things, not only on the model building side, but then also on the results presentation side, and I would say, you know, a big challenge in any of these modeling projects is really convincing the client that what you have, what you've built for them, what you're recommending holds water. Does it make sense? And if so, why? I mean, my professor that taught me systems, you know, the head of the system dynamics group at MIT, just drilled into us from day one. He's like, never say, well, the model says, right? Never just rely on, well, why is this a good answer? Well, because the model says. Because the model says this. So that's not a good enough answer. He's like, you need to have an explanation. You need the model is helping you make good decisions. But if you don't understand why the model is giving you a particular output, then you're going to have a really hard time convincing a client. So I think a big challenge is making sure that we can build transparent models, and the tools that we use are incredibly transparent. I, you know, allow the clients through a visual interface to see every single calculation that is in our model, and they can run sensitivity analysis, and they can do it with a visual user interface. And we work with them in the development of the model to, so that they understand why we're doing things in the model and where our inputs are coming from.
Yes.
Can I just jump in? Because I was sort of...
No, you can't. No, go ahead. Go ahead, Kurt.
I think it's about to get interesting.
Okay.
No, I just wanted to say that I'm definitely not advocating black box solutions for the model. It's more that when dealing with a lot of data, when dealing with some of these new techniques, the challenge is more when you have a client that says, okay, tell me again how a neural network works. And you can explain that on a certain level. I'm not sure that I can guarantee that my clients will always walk away saying, man, I love those neural network things, because that hidden layer, I mean, forget about it. And so again, it's the layers. I'm not advocating the black box solution. I agree with everything that Corey said. I think that's all very valuable. And yet, we as the practitioners and as the deliverers of the solution, we have to recognize that we are also the experts in certain pieces of that. And so there's a subtle art to being able to build that teamwork and that relationship with the users of the model without it having to rely on being able to transfer all of the knowledge and experience that we have into somebody else. Mm-hmm. So that's all.
No, I think that makes sense. I think Corey would agree with that too.
Oh yeah, I don't
actually
think
mean, so.
Oh man,
too much of a disagreement. No.
Well, I mean, there's always that level. I mean, that you can't show them everything the model does,
right.
But you need to show them what's important, probably.
Right. Exactly.
And so that. So amazing. What's a lesson learned from your kind of complex? I mean, these models that you build must be very complex. I mean, kind of, what's a lesson learned for people facing that kind of challenge?
So, yes, we have a passion for building these decision support solutions for ongoing use. But the key lesson that I'd like to leave the audience with is, don't jump into that directly. Make sure you have worked with that organization on smaller strategy projects. For example, if we go back to the Deepwater Division, Gulf of Mexico portfolio management system, we had done work on corridor strategies or basin level strategies with that organization for 2 or 3 years before they asked us for a area-wide portfolio management system. And the learnings there, and having done it several times, they were starting to parameterize the assessment curves for development capex for types of wells based on the depth of water and the depth of objectives. So they were working towards that. So having done the smaller strategy projects will help you get to the decision support solution for the enterprise. So never jump directly into that. That's one key lesson. The other thing I would say, some of the hard work is really not the very exciting work. Some of the hard work, whether you do it yourself or you have a team guiding another organization or an internal team doing that, a lot of times, if the organization doesn't have a clear data analytics strategy and they don't have this culture of being data-driven in their decision, you'll have to do a lot of work on the data extraction, cleansing, integration, and you'd have hoped that they've done it. And that's why, going back to the first learning, having done the smaller projects first will get you ready and get the organization ready for having their data in place and clean enough to do the more exciting decision support solution work. So that's the second thing. And the third key lesson, and that's from multiple projects, is come up with a prototype using Excel. It's very easy to prototype using Excel before you go into web-based development. So in some of the projects we've done recently, we prototype in Excel, then we move into Tableau as the second version, then the third version would be a completely web-based system. And above all, you need full buy-in for this, the decision support solution from the C-level all the way down to the organization. And to make it stick, you want to make sure that the system is continuously be updated. And for that, you need to make sure you're supporting not only the strategic decisions, but also the week-to-week, a quarter-to-quarter decisions that people who are going to be taking care of the system, be the custodians of the system, have an interest in keeping it updated, that you're making their lives easier, you're making these quarterly decisions easier, and this is how it will stick with the organization.
I think that's a problem that we have with every project that we do. So I want to turn to some questions. We've gotten a few questions here. One question kind of at the top of the list is, you know, as modelers, How do you deal with a situation where you have too few data points instead of too many? We have another question about, is large data always better? That follows us. So this kind of, I think, is links to that. And, you know, we've been working on a model that has 200 parameters to be estimated, and we have 70 data points. And so clearly, that's kind of an issue. People over-design the models that they want us to estimate, put too many segments in it. It's an issue. But so I'd like to have each of you comment on it briefly. I mean, so I think in every model, even if you've got large streams of data, there's something that you want to estimate that you don't have enough data on. And you know, how do you explain that to customers, and how do you deal with that? And this was actually the highest rated question.
You're gonna come to me first every time, aren't
you? Okay, well, let's go to Kurt. Let's go to Kurt. No, I should change that around. I mean, I'm used to picking on you, though, Corey. I mean, years of doing that. So,
all right. You know, I haven't. We deal with sort of two classes of problems. One that has relatively few empirical data points, and so often for those, for example, it might be a research and development product in pharmaceuticals or something. And so we'll work with the client in order to get to elicit some quantitative estimates on distributions around the data. Were we to see these data, how might they be distributed? And that works very well with certain key things. You can try to estimate market size or competition and these various things. And then that's a great basis to be able to do some Monte Carlo simulations, so you can come up with a reasonable estimate of the quantities that you're after. Then over time, you have the opportunity to be able to update that information and improve those estimates in an ongoing manner. There's another group of situations where you sort of have a medium-sized set of data. It's not 50 data points, but it's not 2 million either. And so what do you do? And so clearly, you often just have to adjust your expectations around that. I mean, we've also had cases where we have a lot of data, but they're so noisy. There's so much variability in those data that it's difficult. You can't still come and say, okay, A is clearly better than B. You know, and so there's a lot of education that way. But I think if you're not able to elicit some type of prior distributions on the data, you know, the data that you don't have, if you're not able to do that, then you really have to radically rethink maybe what your focus is and what your objectives are and how you're going to be able to deal with that.
Okay. So, I mean, this seems to be not having data. I mean, you know, you've got expert judgment, you've got other ways of filling it in. What do you do when you just don't have the data that you would like to have to kind of estimate your model? I mean,
We're comfortable usually in that situation where we bring multiple experts on the topic and get the best assessments and make sure that the uncertainty range reflects the uncertainty in the minds of the experts, and sometimes you have to debias them, et cetera. So coming from this school of thought, we're comfortable with these situations. What I'm concerned about, though, is that our school of thought, the DA school of thought, sometimes doesn't take into consideration all the data that's available and bring that to bear and convert the data into knowledge to support decision making. And more in many domains, we're going to be facing that situation. 4 or 5 decades ago, the failure modes were ignorance. People just didn't know whether this protocol is the optimal protocol in this kind of situation or this intervention is the optimal one or not. Nowadays, whether it's in medicine, engineering, in technology, you name it, the failure mode is going to be more and more ineptitude, not bringing to bear all the data that people have access to and the knowledge that is there. And one key reference I would recommend is the Checklist Manifesto. It's an emergency doctor who talks about how in emergency rooms, people are not making the use of all the data that they have available and all the knowledge in medicine. And they need to do that. And that's becoming more and more the failure mode in many decision contexts. So in terms of sparseness of data, I'm not too worried. We have the ways to deal with that. We need to train ourselves to bring all the data that's available in a relevant and material filtering approach that we know to support decision making going forward.
So just to kind of, Corey, I guess I left you out altogether, so maybe I should go to you. But it does seem to me that if you're missing data on something that's important, one of the things you might advise your client is to get some data. Go out there. You're talking about, you know, we've got all kinds of new data collection systems available on distribution systems, for example. I'm less familiar with oil and gas, but you know, we can now put measurement devices and transmitters on substations and on lines all over the place, and it's probably almost easier to collect too much data in some ways. But I think that looking at, if you have valuable information that you're not collecting, a great thing to do is try to work with the client to start collecting that data. But Corey, what do you do when you don't have any data?
We just make it up. For the types of models that we build, they're almost always a causal model of some kind. So there's some theory that underlies it. And if we don't have any data, we are reliant entirely on theory. And in some cases, we'll use data from analogous technologies or similar programs or processes that have been put in place where we can at least have a plausible range of coefficients for a particular technology in terms of likelihood of adoption, speed of adoption, and so forth. So if we're at the very nascent stages of a technology, we just obviously there's more uncertainty and you're just more reliant on theory. The more data that you get, then you have a better ability to then, and if you calibrate your models, and I see actually a lot of people building these same types of models that never even bother to calibrate them. They stay in the world of theory and they never even bother to calibrate them to real world data, and I just think that's a tragedy. So as we get more and more and more data, we are able to further and further refine those coefficients. And I would suggest that in the theory that we're dealing with, for instance, if I want to predict the market long-run market share of a technology as a function of its product attributes, where there's a whole host of theory out there that can be used to help you quantify that. There's discrete choice analysis, conjoint analysis, and so forth that you can use to help fill in the gaps on any historical data to help you forecast long-run data. But I will say that in some cases, I also see, again, worse predictions at greater cost. And one example, and I apologize if there's anybody from the California Energy Commission in the room, they have a market share model for vehicles that is used to forecast, you know, what's likely to happen with the transportation system in California. And they spend tons of money on a discrete choice analysis to try to quantify coefficients of adoption for a whole host of different technologies. And the first thing I did is I was like, all right, well, let's replicate that. And let's see what the response curves are. Let's see what it looks like. Let's see what the market shares look like as a function of different product attributes. And as soon as we did that, because we were trying to forecast electric vehicles, as soon as we did that, we realized that those response curves just don't even pass the laugh test. There is absolutely no way that they are even remotely realistic. And so I would argue that we basically said, all right, let's use the theory. Let's use the market share theory. Let's tweak the coefficients to get a response curve that we at least feel passes the laugh test and at least feel that would be consistent with somebody's beliefs about, you know, the likelihood of adopting a product. And I would suggest that in our case, we probably have far more accurate, realistic, and likely response curves to product adoption using expert judgment than a very, very expensive study that calculated coefficients based on a survey. So I think it's always this competition, I think, between theory and really looking at causality and data. And in some cases, you don't necessarily get better answers with more data if you're not analyzing that data properly.
Okay, so I've got a number of questions here. I want to try to go through them. Some of the questions are very specific to the individuals up here. You know, I would suggest that if you have a question that's very specific to an individual, you catch them out in the hall right after this. And so I'm going to try to go with the questions that seem to be more general in terms. One of them was, we talked about what you do when you have sparse data. What do you do when you have too much data? I mean, is more data always better? The question here specifically is that if you have more data, does that reduce uncertainty in your mind, or does it just help you characterize the uncertainty?
I have a response for that that I was thinking of partly while Corey was speaking as well. I think that we're almost at risk of fetishizing data in the sense that just more data is always better, more data is always better. And often you can achieve fantastic solutions with very limited data. We had a situation recently where we, it wasn't that we had too much data, but there was a very strong attachment at the client to this particular data set. And it was a relatively large data set, and there were a couple of variables in there that were kind of poorly reported. And so the question was, should the client invest money to supplement these variables and get more data so we could resolve this, because it's a very important principle in generating the forecast. But one of the things that we did is we just really focused on understanding the data that we had and how those variables presented, with under the question that if we had more data just like this, would that actually reduce our uncertainty? Would that improve our ability to achieve our objective? So in this case, those data were actually so poorly measured. There was so much error and variability in the reporting of these things in the data that even when you, if you had 2, 3, 4, 5 times more of it, you would still have these very wide intervals around your predictions based on that. And so what we were able to do, so in that case, having more data would not have been better. It would have been more satisfying, maybe, to the client to see that we had a lot of that data. But we could tell numerically and statistically that the information content of those variables was relatively low. So what we did instead of purchasing more data or disregarding those is we actually built a submodel that, it's a term from that people call feature engineering now. In the old days, you would do sort of principal components analysis and kind of refactor your data. What we did is we came up with some surrogate variables that we could use to stand in the place of this. And our surrogate variables, which were synthetic and they were just based completely on patterns in the data, performed as well when we used those as predictors than if we had gone out and purchased all this other stuff. So that's kind of the middle ground. Having more data of that quality would not have improved our ability to do our job, and it wasn't worth the money that we spent on it. There are other variables that they can narrow in, but a key factor is the data generation process. What is being measured, how is it being measured, and how closely related that is to your ultimate objective.
Mason?
I'd like to approach this in a couple of ways. First of all, I'd like to emphasize in these interventions, the importance of what we call multilinguals or trilinguals, at least, people who are very fluent in data analytics and AI and machine learning, people who are very fluent in strategy and decision analysis, and people who are fluent in the industry domain. And you need people who are fluent in these three areas to look at some of the data sets, because sometimes they will be the ones to point something that makes no sense in the data set or identify irregularities, et cetera. So that's important as a role when you're approaching these situations. And then back to our methodology in DA, it affords us to look at the data and scrub it, and then look at, okay, how does this availability of data change the way you're looking at the uncertainty going forward? Does it reduce your uncertainty? Does it not? Is it material to the decision? And then back to the sparseness question you had, will your decision change given the uncertainty range we're dealing with here? And is it better to go out and look for more data or check the data sets that you have? And again, that's the value of information exercise that we do. So we should not forget the tools that come with our own field and make sure we emphasize that. And then I'd like to emphasize another point. We're being asked right now by a client to look at a sample data they have in terms of customer response to a pilot they did on tariff reform to inform decisions on a wider tariff reform project they would do in terms of adjusting the tariffs for utilities in a specific part of the world. So we're taking two approaches, a classical approach, econometric-driven approach, and we're taking also a machine learning-based approach, because the machine learning, we will not be able to explain exactly what's going on, so you need to compare it to another methodology and see if you're comfortable with the insights that you're generating. So in cases where you have a lot of data and you need to use machine learning or other methodologies, you need to also be able to benchmark and make sure that the results are in line with your intuition.
Okay. So, Corey, I know that you have access to potentially humongous data sets. How does that help you or hurt you?
All right, I've got 20 seconds here. I'll try to give you a 20-second answer. I do see a tendency for people to try to throw everything in the kitchen sink into a model. If they've got data or if they can get data, they want to put it in there. They want additional detail. They want additional granularity. And I would caution or have cautioned that oftentimes that can, again, result in worse predictions if you don't actually have a theoretical or a basis for which to show a causal relationship between this additional detail that you put in your model over here and what's going to come out the other end. If you don't have that, if you don't have some basis for that causal relationship and you're relying purely on what is probably an inaccurate data set, you can spend a lot more time and money on analyzing, getting processing that data, running the model, and get worse results out the tail end than if you just kept it simpler and balanced your data availability and quality with your theory and your ability to assign causation.
That sounds great. We're at time. I think some of the questions we got were great questions. You couldn't get to them. But the questions themselves, I think, are insightful. One was, we need to make decisions, not predictions. They draw a distinction between forecasting and prediction and supporting good decision making. Great point. Challenges in helping the clients make decisions, kind of working through the culture. Those issues are huge in every project we work in. I think those are kind of insightful questions. We had a number of questions that were very specific to these individuals. You know, they asking Corey a specific question, Kurt a specific question, using terminology that I didn't even know. So I figured that, you know, that's probably better to do one-on-one with the experts working in the area. But I think one of the things that really came across is these people are practitioners. They work with this stuff every single day, and they've all had great success at helping their clients. And so I want to thank these people for agreeing to be on this panel. I think it was very insightful. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Dan.